Welcome everybody to our first lecture. This is really fun part of Catalyst Week as we have all of these amazing lectures condensed into 1 week. So it just adds to the overall kind of intensity and the contributes to what a great learning experience this week is and will be. I'm really excited to have Luke here. I'm excited to have him as our first lecturer. Luke was a classmate of mine at Rice University in the School of Architecture, and it's really interesting kind of case study and what you can do with an architecture degree besides architecture. He was an amazing designer in school, but chose to go into graphic design instead of architecture, and it's been really fun for me to watch his career unfold and flourish as a graphic designer, working in New York for the past 10 plus years. Luke got his undergraduate degree from the University of New Mexico, and he was a dual major in architecture and dance. So maybe he'll do a little
something. That's all I did.
Yeah, that was it?
That's
okay, yeah.
But if you watch later on in the Catalyst, you might see some pretty hilarious stuff going
on. I don't doubt it. And Luke, it was really interesting to watch how Luke kind of brought dance to bear on his design work when he was in school. I always remembered that about working alongside him. And then he got his, as I mentioned, his MArch degree from Rice University. And then at Rice, he stayed on as the director of publications and exhibitions for 4 years. And that's where he really developed his chops as a graphic designer and did some really beautiful publications for Rice University, which I still have. Everyone who was in school at that time remembers all the exciting visual material that came out of the school from that time. He went to Michigan in 2003, 2004, and was a Sanders Fellow, teaching at Michigan for a year. And then from there he went to New York and officially kind of started his office. His office was known as Thumb Design for a number of years, but now it's recently undergone a name change to Luke Bulman Office. Luke works with a really prestigious set of publishers, from Lars Mueller to Birkhauser to Yale University Press to Actar. I mean, if you have, all of you have architecture books, and these are covering quite a few of the really great publishers. And so these are pretty difficult publishers to get in with as a graphic designer. And so it's remarkable that Luke's built up such an amazing list of clients like this. I love having Luke here, and Luke's been, as you know, doing a lot of the graphic design material for the school. So the Catalyst poster and the pink sleeve booklets that you saw around the lecture poster from the first half of the year. And it's great working with Luke because while he's not a practicing architect, his wheelhouse of expertise lies directly squarely in the middle of architecture. He understands architecture. He was trained as an architect, and so he's got this great kind of crossover career. I really look forward to your lecture, and please welcome Luke Bulman.
Thanks, Mark. And also thanks to Blaine Brownell also for hosting me and Blair for the Catalyst. It was a really fun morning. We did selfies. They're pretty hilarious too. And I also want to say thanks to Andrew for pulling everything together and supporting bringing all of us together for this Catalyst. I think it's a pretty cool thing to be in a big room with everybody and to see all these kind of various projects, like getting started and getting underway. In the nature of workshops, I wanted to show this project here, which you see short short film of, which is a bootleg version of a publication called Oblique Strategies, which was developed by Brian Eno, that Brian Eno, who was in Roxy Music and invented Ambient, with a friend of his named Peter Schmidt, who was a painter. And they were they found themselves finding that they had similar problems when they were in the studio, of like working up against into a corner and not knowing exactly how to get out. And they developed this set of cards called the Oblique Strategies, which helped them to kind of break out of those corners, while recognizing that those corners were actually potentially productive areas. So typically, this thing is a super expensive set of cards that's been produced in many, many editions, around $700 for one of those. I didn't want to pay that, I made a bootleg edition of it, and so what you can do with this, if you go to this, this will be up at the end too. If you go to that that URL. At the bottom there, you can download a PDF from which that was made. I consider this educational fair use if you're a copyright person. You can download that and you can cut out those cards and you can have your own set of oblique strategies. They are really, really, it's a super useful thing. And moreover, during a week like this where you're working really fast and you can run into corners a lot, of course, you're going to be working with alongside your colleagues and with critics who are going to be pointing that out to you. But this little thing sitting on your desk next to you could be super useful. So I'd really recommend doing that. So there's a little gift at the end of the rainbow. So it's kind of fitting in a way to kind of kick off this this section of the discussions, because in a way, like, The practice that I have is very much predicated on representation, because we're working in the world of publication, and publication is essentially just making all of those different representations expand and proliferate into the world, so that what we're really interested in is the distribution of ideas. So I'm going to show you a few images just of our work from the studio. You may recognize these hands that are in there. That's my colleague Camille Sasha Salvador, who's here with us this week too, because we're working on a publication for the school. Here you see her adamantly ripping through the pink belly band on the I'm going to show a couple of images of the work, but I'm not going to primarily talk about the work of the studio. I'm going to talk about this other thing that I've been doing for the last 8 years, which has been this seminar at Yale School of Architecture called Books in Architecture. And that class has been kind of like a 8-year workshop in a way. And It's really about figuring out exactly what the book is for architecture, as not just as a mode of representation, but also as something that also internally organizes the discipline and practice of architecture. So but I'll say a couple words about our work anyway. We make books primarily. 80% of the work that we do is book related. The other part that we do is environmental graphics, which is basically, if you blow a book up in a building and distribute it, that's environmental graphics. So in other words, signage and that sort of thing. So all our work is in some way related to architecture and spatiality, I guess you could say. So I'm just showing a few of those. Few of those book projects as we kind of move through there. But this talk, I wanted to kind of present as sort of what's classically referred to as an apology for the book, in that it's trying to describe the relative importance of this medium, I think, today, which I think a lot of people have kind of, I think, incorrectly kind of said that there is actually going to be the death of the book, but I think that's absolutely false. There will be a transformation of the book, clearly, just as all media respond to other media in order to respond to the way that our attentions shift. But the most, there's a couple of like really super fundamental things about books that I don't think are gonna go away. And to me, that's the most important one. That in a way, books are ideas, they are vehicles for the development of ideas, but also the proliferation of ideas. And obviously those things are done, those ideas proliferate along many, many, many different lines. But the line of the book, or the nature, the particular nature of the book, I think makes it different than many other things. So while the book itself is a recording, let's say a recording of a set of ideas, it's not just its essential fact of itself that's important, but the fact that it kind of oozes. That's oozing going on. Oozing, that's a weird word to use, but I like it. Oozing in the sense that every book is part of a sort of an environment. If we kind of understand media as through an environmental metaphor, we can understand that all of these things are kind of interacting in an ecological sort of way. And so that the book takes up a certain part of that ecology, and it's always in relationship to other books and relationship to other media. So it's always, it's participating. And I think that that's one of the things that makes it most interesting to us, and interesting for publishers, sometimes profitable for them, sometimes not, mostly not. But it also kind of presents certain opportunities. So for Blair, I present this next this next slide. So there are you could say that there's this thing that might make us think that maybe books might not matter, and it couldn't be more succinctly stated than that. There's a study that this image attended with, which was that by the time children were 6 months old, a typical child was 6 months old, they spend an hour a day potentially on a screen, 6 months old. So this is the thing that people typically say, like, oh my God, the book is dead. But there's something, and I think any parents in this room would say, is that there's something very special about the book as an object, and the way that it displaces space, and the way that it has tactility, and the way that it has, actually it has an incredible kind of slowness to it, which is a huge advantage, right? You can't switch apps midstream when you're in a book. It requires a certain degree of dedication, and that dedication, a kind of a blindering, is a really, really useful thing. And I think increasingly as we, if it's increasing, I'm not sure, but if we are increasingly facing a more and more rapid kind of engagement with media, these devices, this old technology called the book is going to become increasingly important, and some aspects of it will be critical, I think, to kind of the slower aspects, the more reflective aspects, and the more physical aspects of interacting with information will be found in it. So the way I want to organize this thing is this talk is to talk about the old interrogative model, which comes from reporting, which is the who, what, where, when, why of books matter. So I'm gonna talk about a few things within that framework and just kind of sequence it that way. Caveat to that is that Jean-Luc Godard said that he liked to have a beginning, a middle, and an end, in a movie, but not necessarily in that order. And so that's why I'm starting with four, not with one, so don't freak out. This is like, this little phenomena is like, in some ways, the simplest phenomena of the book. It is, it's the temporal aspect of the book. Every book, in a way, like every book is kind of a, is like a little thickened chunk of time that that you kind of work through over different kind of durations depending on the nature of that content. So like this guy, like right here, this little like, you know, 4-second flip book has that duration. That duration is then is kind of communicated through a series of pages. And those pages are sequenced in such a way as to produce a certain experience and effect. And so there is this very intimate relationship between the kind of temporal aspects of that book, it's how it kind of unfolds over time, and its physical aspects, its space, right? So basically books are then what? They're basically spatial and temporal. They're about organizing a set of experiences over a series of spaces that occur over time. Now, that isn't architecture. I don't know what is, right? So when you start to think about this kind of, and when I'm talking about books today, I'm talking very specifically about books related to architecture. So that's what we do. So there is this really strong relationship between this, the kind of book as a design object, a design proposition, and architecture as a design proposition. They do similar things. They scale differently. They have different distribution models. There's obviously vast differences in some ways. But if you give me 4 weeks with any of you architects, I can make you a really good book designer. Because once you realize that these things are fundamentally the same, like the action and activity of designing a book is very similar to the action and activity of designing a building, you'd be a really good designer. So that's kind of the most fundamental interaction, is that we're making spatial temporal propositions. And this one is a little bit more bound into the idea about what the practice is. So what books matter? I'm going to talk about one book in particular. Not for very long, if you're not a historian buff, but that book called 10 Books of Architecture by Vitruvius, which that book basically established architecture as a profession. It kind of validated architecture as a profession. So there's this, to this day, still, there is this, this sense, I think, many, many architects feel this, I think, now, is that their work is best suited to the book. That in some ways, they don't exist because they have a website. They exist and are validated through the book. So there is this, there's a very, very strong kind of historical relationship between thinking about, or the representation and the formation of the practice and discipline relative to that book and many other, like Alberti and so on. We can go through the whole kind of lineage. But the thing that I want to kind of point out, and I'm using a couple of images from one edition of the 10 Books of Architecture, is that book is about the world. It's an encyclopedia, basically. It's an encyclopedia of describing the architect's crafts and skills and knowledge as it relates to the world. It's not just about column orders. Part of it's about column orders, but it's also about war machines, and it's also about astronomy, and it's about how to move water from a lower area to a higher area. It's about proportion. It's about the experience of of visuality. It's about making plaster. There's a whole section on plaster. So that book, that one book, I think kind of establishes this this validity for this type of practice. And so why architecture books matter is because it has this really foundational relationship to the book, to architecture. And it's not just at that stage, it's also at basically every historical moment you see architecture and architects communicating their ideas through A, the building, but B, the book. So here's an image, this is one of my all-time favorite images, of all the books that Corbusier, Le Corbusier, produced during during his 40 years of practice. That's 53 plus or minus books, depending on what you define as a book, which is a whole nother issue. But throughout the practice, there was this idea that in order for there to be an engagement and a kind of open figure, if you will, between the practice and the world, the book was the thing that was going to do that. It provided a way for things to come into the practice. So if you think about that book called Aircraft, like Korb's book on aircraft, a bunch of pictures of aircraft. But it also is about, it's also about the practice projecting outside of the confines of a particular client group. So if you think about the Oeuvre complète, so you know, in that multiple volume set, you see the entire output of that practice. So there is, and then there's also these like beautiful little popularizations as well, like Petite Maison and the Right Angle, the poem in the Right Angle. So there are also almost like these children's books aspects to the publishing practice as well. So it was a way for Korb to actually kind of both internally organize the practice, but also to think about how the ideas of the practice kind of met the public. So that is why it's called publication, after all. And we can look at any, like I said, we can look at any number of practices that do that. You could also look at Buckminster Fuller, who is, you know, really like producing books from the 30s all the way through the 60s. It's a really pretty amazing thing, just like the historical arc of production over that period. But if you think about, I don't know if you've ever looked at any of those books, but there's some super experimental, weird books in that. Just look at I Seem to Be a Verb Someday if you want to like see a really freaky book. That guy was incredible. And the way that we know that is through the artifacts. They really are artifacts from that practice. But the ideas are really kind of formulated, refined, and communicated through the book. And those books, you know, those books remain huge sellers today. Lars Mueller, one of the publishers we work with, has the rights to the publishing of those, and that's like a huge staple of his publishing list. So we know that if you have, I mean, everybody said like he was living in the future, and it's amazing that we have this record of that body of work, because we can actually look at that kind of really intense environmental thinking, that's kind of holistic thinking, and we see that today, and we think that is incredibly relevant to us. So the book is doing this thing where it's reaching across time, and it's also transcultural. It is able to be shared across the world. So it's a super powerful thing. So the other aspect of the book that I think is important, that touches on the design, and I'm only going to talk about this for a second, is the design and the kind of the physical fact of the book also can have very strong analogs to architectural form making or material sensibilities. So like this is one of my favorite images of just a sketch. This is just a sketch for the kind of physical body of a book. It has this particular book has no content in it, but it's purely an idea about how can we combine these different materials, hold them together, and then understand those as having an affect to them. So that, like a proposition like that, has direct analogs into how we detail and think about architecture. Those amazing, well, I don't know if you like them that much, but the difference between that door handle and the door handle on the front of the building is vast. So the same thing happens with the book. Those kinds of expressions very much are part of the experience and the and the kind of vitality of a book. So the vitality of a book is found in it's found in its material facts, just as it is in architecture. So you have these, like, you have these overlaps between history, like the history of architecture as a practice, the book as this kind of validating expression of architecture, and then you also have the kind of the idea about the book as a physical proposition. Those things tie it together. So I want to talk about it. So when I'm working on these projects with people, architects, architects to be, like you, we work on a number of different projects because I think that the way to learn about books is to make books. And so we do that in a bunch of different ways. It's not just about like making dummies, like basically making physical propositions. Yeah, it's about looking at and thinking about how can we engage with the history of architecture through books in order to kind of understand where we're at. One of the projects that that we've been doing for, I think this is going to be the fourth year of this project, is called Expand. And basically what it does is it takes a canonical, or in my opinion, a canonical book of architecture and basically blows it up. Michael, blowing things up. Yeah, good. It blows it up. As a way of testing, you know, that idea, that proposition that Mies had about the interrelationship that architecture is engaged with its time. And so we said, okay, Mies, what was your time? And so what we do in each one of these instances, we actually have a Friotto book too, by the way. Friotto blow up. We blew up Friotto. I want to show you that later. I have one still from it later. But basically what we do is we look at things that are happening in popular culture, whether it's like material culture or film. This is it's a cover from Life magazine. And we look for these kinds of moments where you get this shift and you get this overlap or contrast or misnomer between what is being stated in the architecture, I think it's Toronto Dominion on the right, and simultaneous with that we have Gene Kelly performing in, I think it's American in Paris, I think at that time. So you get these juxtapositions that are, on one level, they're like purely formal, right? The exuberance that you see on the left can be said to be found in the exuberance on the right. Or you might also get the overlap of Disney and the pastoral landscape. So that happy little bird is the same nature that is the happy little trees that surround a Miesian courtyard. So we can have that. So the architectural proposition is not so isolated after all when you actually start to crack it open. But then there's also this, there's a potential to kind of understand it as being a critical tool as well. So on the one hand, I think this is, on the right is Seagram's, the Seagram's boardroom. And then on the left is a lunchroom counter sit in 1962, I think. So you get this kind of book, which is about making these propositions. And some of them are purely kind of accidental propositions. You don't really realize the simultaneity of things. The fact that Crown Hall opened at the same year that Mel Gibson was born. You don't realize these things, right? But they're important. But what happens is that the book then becomes this kind of thinking tool. You could write an essay there. That's 2,000 words, easy, right? So it becomes the tool, the book becomes a tool for thinking really broadly and really thinking like, and thinking in a kind of specific way about what the relationships potentially can be between an architectural proposition and the actual time in which it was being proposed. And of course, we're looking at that in hindsight at the same time. And so we're bringing with us our kind of contemporary kind of sensibility and ideas about what's just or what composes like a formal proposition, what makes things make sense relative to a time and how those things get expressed. So the way that, so just as a kind of one thing before I move to the next part, you can see some of those, you can see some of those kind of actions. So the original book, the Werner Blasser Mies van der Rohe book is shown in gray, is always printed on gray paper. And then anything that is injected into the book is printed on yellow paper. So that's an essay on the cruciform. So there's the essay on the cruciform that precedes the pavilion, so that when you start to look at that cruciform column, which we all know so well from architectural history and looking at Mies, it starts to have a different meaning. It ties into culture in a totally different way than we might have thought about it before. It's also, the other thing that is kind of significant about this is that we're also using visual research as the predominant mode of research. It's not a textual, not so much, I mean, we still do some of that. It's not a textual research, it's more of a visual research project. And so that allows us to work very quickly. These books expand from around 200 to around 500 pages, and we're able to do that in about 2 weeks. So we're able to move really, really quickly to produce ideas that have that potentially have a lot of echo to them, and I think that's what we're interested in. So whose books matter? It's a slight modification from whose, but the answer to that is our books. Our books matter. This is a really popular diagram. I've been in lectures in the last year or so, and I've seen it like five times. But I think it's so good still. Making books is easy. All you gotta do is have three chords. A, E, G. And basically you can jump in. So it's if you start to think about the book as being like a research tool, the book then can become something that is actually really embedded into the process. It doesn't have to be something that is produced post facto, right, after the production of the project. It can act throughout the project. And so I want to show you a little case study, the historical case study, to kind of demonstrate this. Go relatively quickly through that. One of my favorite artists, I guess he's an artist, he says he's an artist, is Ed Ruscha. Ed Ruscha, born in Oklahoma, but moved to California to go to the Schoenart Institute, I believe it was, but had worked also at a printing house where they made books. And he, in the process of kind of going back and forth between Oklahoma and California, he collected a series of photographs. And these photographs of like basically the American landscape and this kind of like western landscape where you have, you know, vast horizontal distances, horizons, and these punctuations of commercial culture, 66, Highway 66 type culture, became really, really huge influences on him. If you know his work, you can kind of identify these as being kind of like the seeds, right? The seeds of all those amazing paintings and prints. But it's this stupid thing that he did, right? Just like snaps. He just took snaps of gasoline stations all the way from Oklahoma all the way to LA. I don't know where in Oklahoma. But he started thinking about those lists and started thinking about those images, and he started thinking, huh, that's actually make a pretty nice book if you kind of put them together. So he took 26 of those, and he produced what's considered to be like one of the very first arts books that's called that are called multiples. And with the pointed idea of not producing an artist book that is like a precious singular thing, but something that is about the mass production of something and about the distribution of that thing and about how those ideas might get out. And it basically moved books from being something that was like precious into being something that was commodified in a sense. And there's a really great show at the Walker in which one of Ruscha's books plays a very prominent, or has a very prominent position, called 34 Parking Lots. Can you guess what's in 34 Parking Lots? 34 parking lots, shot from the sky. And then 26 gasoline stations. Yep, 26 gasoline stations. 9 swimming pools?
Is it 9 swimming pools?
No. It's 8 swimming pools and a broken glass. So you started playing games with it, right? It's a really super simple book. It's kind of like, they're crummy photos. It's the first thing he says. It's about a direct kind of relationship between what you see, research, right? What you see, and producing some kind of a crystallization of that thing, some kind of an embodiment of that thing, which can then get into the world. So if you look at site plan of the project, you can see the whole thing from an aerial point of view, and you can see the distribution of those images, how there's white and black spaces, there's 3 night images, there's a certain kind of anatomy that you can kind of see here. So we made those books, 500, I think it was 500 in the first run. And one of the first steps that you make when you're making a book, if you want it to be recognized, is you send it to the Library of Congress, which was at the time, maybe still is, the largest collection of books in the United States, if not the world. But his book was soundly rejected. It was not. They said it wasn't actually a book, and so thus the legend began. Right, so then he promptly made an ad to go in Art Forum magazine, which basically said, "Look at how valid my book is." It was rejected by the U.S. government in 1963, October 2nd, 1963, and then you could buy a copy from National Excelsior, which is his bullshit company name. You know what Excelsior is, right? It's like stuffing for a package. And so you could write and get one of those books for him from him for that. So today, if you go and you try to get this is even a second edition copy of 26 Gasoline Stations, you can see how successful he was. So he made $1,500, right? He sold all the editions of that book, and he made $1,500. And so now you can't even buy one of those for that amount. Okay, so. That whole thing, that whole process there, that's something that lots of people do today. Basically, you can do everything. You can be the author, you can be the editor, you can be the designer, you can be the printer, you can be the publisher, you can be the distributor, you can do everything. Because of the way that our economy works now, everything becoming more connected, it's very it supports the idea of a self-initiated publishing project. So I say, like, whose books? Our books. All right. Oh, I need to just mention what this is really quickly. So one of the projects, the very first project that people do, this is something I would really strongly recommend that you all do. This is a really fun project to do. And it basically asks you to collect 256 images that matter to architecture, and it's up to you to decide what those images are and what sequence they are. But in the end, you have to defend why they matter. And so I'm at Yale, and so there's some degree of kind of classicism involved. So you get the Hand of David as being something that matters to architecture. Its symbolism, I think, relative to the political climate at the time, is probably part of that. Plus, it's beautiful. But you also have like the role of like an axonometric drawing, flatness, those kinds of things matter to architecture. So these are just a series of images from those 256 books, fractals. some idea about the temporal arrangement of a model relative to some SCSI stuff on the right. This is a kind of a nice one. This is a Bridget Riley, the op art painter on the right, and then the TWA terminal on the left. So you can begin to draw these kinds of associations and the reasoning behind each one of those individuals' book about what matters to architecture. Metabolism, yes. Yeah, why not, right? Beautiful, blurry thing. Right? If the world's worth binding, don't ever do that. And then there's another, so another Frank Lloyd Wright, this time paired with a Terrell sky space image, right? So that project is typically, they have about a week to do that. And it's like boot camp for bookmaking. I strongly recommend that you try that sometime. I'll loop back at the end and tell you how useful that can be for a different reason. So why where books matter? Yeah, number three. But it's actually much closer to the end than you think. Used to be, like the books used to be stored in monasteries. Then we had like the invention of the library. You have these reading rooms, which came along with the bookshelf. The bookshelf gets invented. Crazy to think that actually had to be invented, right? But it had to be invented because of these things. And the idea about the democratization of knowledge coming through the book as the unit, but the library as the kind of container for those things, this kind of public site where information was freely, you know, freely exchanged as long as you were you were literate, I guess. but still, the idea that there would become these spaces within our cities and within our culture where ideas could be freely exchanged, and they were beautiful spaces, right? And we still have those spaces, right? Well, it's a matter of opinion too. Like on the left. There's the OMA, Seattle Public Library. This is actually the reading room. Not all the rooms in there are reading rooms. There's some other weird things called like mixing chambers and so on. But there still is, there's a different disposition of those books relative to the building, but there still is a role, for the book within that broader idea of what constitutes media. And there still is this kind of like relationship between the body and furniture and the book and the architecture, which is kind of, it's still stable to a big degree. On the right is Bill Arts's Utrecht library. And I just want to say, it's a black building with red furniture and then books stuffed in it. That just sounds so good, right? But then the mama is here at Yale, and this is like the ultimate, this thing is like the ultimate like pin to the book and architecture. If you go to New Haven, you gotta see it. It's completely surreal. It's the weirdest building I've ever been in. And I also hate this building. Because look what it's done. These are very, obviously it's the rare book collection, sorry. It's the rare book collection at Yale. It holds like a phenomenal collection of things. But if it could be any more remote to get one of those books, I don't know how you would do it. It's unobtainium that you have behind those behind those things. All right. So that's not to say that like the library is really, the library is just kind of like one scale of space in which we find ourselves with books. And so this is something that I just kind of want to get you to see, which is, this is the Frankfurt Book Fair, which is the world's largest book fair, which is held in, it's held in October in Frankfurt. And at every, more or less at every Frankfurt Book Fair, about 400,000 new books are presented. So you get 400,000 new books every year, and it gets laid out in this kind of like trade show kind of fashion. So this is like scale. This is the scale of the book trade. It remains it remains a very strong, very vital portion of the economy, but obviously, like, it's becoming slightly destabilized. It looks like Vegas, right? But there's also this kind of like, there's some smaller scales at which architecture and the book are kind of playing out. And so you have these things called book fairs, which have proliferated quite a lot in recent years, where that role of the book, which is shifting towards being something that's more rarefied, this is where those books are actually being validated now. So that you don't really want to buy your War and Peace, well, you might, War and Peace in this big fat book when you got an iPad to read it on. So what happens is novels and like simple word flow type documents kind of sit on those types of devices, and so the book as a record of visual material becomes much stronger, and so the book also needs to become more and more kind of a physical presence in order for it to be established, and these book fairs are the kind of playground in which that process happens. So you get these really kind of like super vital, this is not a book fair, but I just love that image. You get these super vital spaces where books and information are being exchanged, and it has to do with this kind of quasi exhibition and retail space that's kind of overlapping. So there's almost like there's a typology of a mixed typology that's kind of developing. So a few years ago, we had the opportunity to kind of participate in one of those book fairs with the Yale Project, and so I brought the 256 project there, but I had 4 years of 256 projects. So if you have I might get the math wrong on this, but it's pretty close. 4 years, more or less 12 students each, 256. That's 16,392 images that matter to architecture. So this book show, this show was basically showing those 256 book projects, and you could actually, each one of them is kind of a statement in itself about this is what matters to architecture. But when you look at them as an aggregate, you can also see what matters to architecture, because it's such an incredibly, it's a quite a large cross-section of images. So we laid out these books, actually, and you can see like up here, on the video monitor. On the video monitor, you can see one of those expand books kind of rolling by. But basically, what these book spaces are like is there's individuals who come in, pick up a book, sit on one of the benches that we bought, enjoy flipping through a few of those books. If you don't want to look at the books, you can stare at the flowers. And so that becomes this kind of quasi public space where the book is, it's no longer is it like in a library, but it's in a space of exchange and a space of kind of exhibition, which is quite different. But you know, the book keeps going, so we can also have that, which is somebody's fantasy. This is a rendering. Somebody's fantasy of like the best bathroom ever, which is composed of a Carrara marble bathtub with the entire like collected works of some library. So we're moving down in scale. So the book is kind of like going along as we move along in scale. And that's one of the things that's really amazing about it, is it has this incredible portability. So it has a strength to it that is coming from its scale, it's coming from its ubiquity, and it's coming from our kind of vital interests in like learning. And so it even goes to be that small. So this is the world's smallest Quran, which is very small. So you can imagine that, you know, the book and its vitality of where it goes is a very strong aspect of why it remains important. Okay, so why do books matter? This is like the end of that. Just to cap, is they matter because it's a way for us to engage with architectural history. The way that we can kind of participate is is through looking at those books, but also operating on those books, beginning to question the things that are in those books by working with them, not just having them sit on the shelf, but engaging with them. And the other thing about the book that really, I think, really matters, this is another one of those exhibition spaces, is that it produces new publics, new ways of kind of thinking about how what commonalities we have with a range of people. And that book can be a sort of a lubricant to that kind of communication. And then the last thing that makes them really amazing is the kind of absolute kind of physicality of those things, that they have a sensuousness to them which makes their information in them come to us in a way that enters into our consciousness in a different way than a screen does. It's just different. It activates pathways that are not, it's not possible to activate through screens. So that's why books matter. And I'm putting this up again in case you want to download that that thing. You can go to that website. That that website has some of the work that we've done, the research work that we've done at Yale on books and architecture. But it also has this vaguely illegal PDF that you could download. Okay, so thank you very much. Good luck on your catalyst.
We have a few minutes for questions, if there are any questions for Luke.
I have a question.
Yes.
I've noted from working with you that you have you take almost like a structural approach to graphic design. You think a lot about the tactility and materiality of books in a way that and I've worked with a few other graphic designers, don't think of that. Do you think that's because of your background in architecture, or is it something else that interests you about that dimension of books?
I think it is. It's related because, you know, you get interested in like how to make things. Mm-hmm. And if you want to make things that have certain effects, you have to familiarize yourself with the process of the manufacturing processes. Mm-hmm. And once you kind of familiarize yourself with that, you start to see those potentials. And that's obviously a super architecture kind of way of thinking about things.
Yeah.
But the structures that you talk about have to do with like the size of sheets of paper as they're produced, the machines that they go through, how many times you can fold them, what the differences are between like using one paper and another paper. All those things are, I think, very architectural. That's not to say like a lot of the design practices graphic design practices which I admire have that as a major component.
Mm-hmm.
One in particular, Mevis van Dersen from Amsterdam, always have had a very strong component of their work to that, and also to a lesser degree, in my interest, Irma Bohm also does. The physicality of the thing is part of the process. The thing that I particularly am interested in is how those things align with content. So it isn't just like applying a method on top of to a book. It's like trying to find what's inside that set of messages,
mm-hmm.
in order to find what that form is,
mm-hmm.
and then trying to understand the intersection of that with manufacturing process.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you can get those things to work, then you're making things that I think have by a fallout in a way like more of a physicality to them.
Mm-hmm.
I think the more, it's a little bit tricky, is that like some projects afford more flexibility than others in those regards. So like the larger, when we work with larger publishers, the constraints are much higher on the manufacturing process. So like working, when we get to work with you and people on projects where we don't have to worry so much about how is this book gonna sit in the library and how's it going to last 25 years,
mm-hmm.
we can be more broadly experimental.
Right.
And so those projects become really important to us because they're partially acting as a little bit of R&D
mm-hmm.
For thinking about like, well, what is the potential, what are the potential outcomes that we could get out of this?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a lot more, it's a lot, there's a lot more freedom in that. We also find that when we're working with, we work with a large number of art-related organizations, museums, small museums and such, and those projects tend to have a more redolent sort of physicality to them, and because the people we work with under those circumstances usually have a very, very subtle sense of materiality
mm-hmm.
And how quiet something can be or how loud something should be.
Mm-hmm.
So those constraints are also equally interesting to work with. Yeah. We also love budgetary constraints like architects in a way because that helps us, right? It helps
right.
us to like know what can we do.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not that we don't want no money to do the project, but we don't want all the money
mm-hmm.
because all the money is really, really hard to work with.
Mm-hmm.
But we manage. We can manage.
Given the opportunity, you could.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We usually know what we
working
can do.
With all the money.
Yeah. All the money. Yeah. Yeah.
You talked about the portability of the book,
mm.
and it makes me think of like emailing a book across the world.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk more about the portability and how?
Yeah, it's a slight reference to this thing. That was in this book called Notre Dame by Victor Hugo, where there's a chapter in there. Sorry, architects, is gonna be rough. it's called This Will Kill That, and it basically talks about how the book basically superseded architecture as the medium by which information was being communicated. So. The Gothic cathedral and the stained glass program was the primary means by which the Gospels were being communicated up until basically the invention of the printing press. And then once you had that invention of that printing press, then the distribution of information accelerated immensely. So that old means of communication, the distribution of cathedrals across this talking about Europe, right, became superseded by the book, right. So today, it's very different. Obviously, the book hardly even matters. It's quite a slow in terms of the rapid distribution of information. We can do it much, much faster with a PDF, let's say. The thing is, so that means that what the book can do now is quite different and a little bit more focused in that it can act in a more reflective capacity rather than acting as a primary means of distribution for information. So that whole process, I mean, that was a 20th century problem. It's not really the problem today, but we see the kind of the repercussions of it more strongly today. So if you go to a bookstore now, like the books that you see that are on the tables, right? When you walk in, there are books on shelves. Those don't matter. The books on the tables are the ones that are going to sell. Those all have this like really strong kind of physicality. Whether that's like super bright colors or papers which are like thick and like all these kind of different things that make you want that object. And so what books are going to be still doing in 20 years and 100 years is doing that. Their role as these kind of information distributors is slightly less. Caveat: if you don't have electricity, how do you read? Right? The book still has the amount of money it takes to make a book relative to buying an electrical infrastructure. there's a vast difference there. So I think we do tend to see like this death of the book problem as being a first world kind of problem, but the book is still very, very, it's a fundamental kind of way of distributing information and learning and all these things that participates in world cultures in a very, very prominent way. So in a way, it's kind of like, it's a crisis. It's a crisis in one location, but it's not a crisis in other locations. Yes?
I really love the Lee Spanero mashup.
Yeah.
And I want to see the Buckminster Fuller one as well. But what it's got me thinking on is something that's very particular to the aesthetics of the book and the way in which it allows different pieces of information, be they textual or visual, to come together. Mm-hmm. And so many people are talking continually about, let's say, the role of precedent in the world of Google image search.
Yeah.
Things now are a continual mashup, a flow of images that are constantly running through, curated not by people, but curated by algorithms of different kinds of recognizable similarities. And what I find kind of amazing about that proposition you put forward by expanding or blowing up the book as something that already exists by jacking into it other kinds of images is that the book still, more so than anything we do on the internet in terms of scrolling through something, mm-hmm. The book actually operates through random juxtapositions of things that
yeah.
against each other.
Your gesture is actually the exact thing.
That's what you situate yourself
yep.
with that. And so it is, in some ways, interesting that it's both a reflection of a culture which is getting more and more mashed up, but presenting it not in an aesthetic that's old, but in an aesthetic that has a different kind of resonance to the way in which we understand the production of concepts and ideas.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so it's super significant to call it a mashup, because it is, it's about that, it's about sampling, it's about all of these various kinds of modalities of interacting with information that we have now. But the thing that you point to, which is like really important, and that's actually what, what really matters is this, because there's this, rhetorical engine that happens in a book that comes from the two-page spread. And because it has this comparative dimension built into it that we don't have in screens, because in a screen it's a continuous space, whereas here we have a bifurcated space which always asks us, okay, this thing on the left is this thing on the right is this, and I have to deal with that. I have to figure out what is the resolution of that. So it is a sort of a it's sort of a thesis, antithesis, and synthesis problem at every spread. So the book, you can design a PDF so that it has a division of the two into two sides, but it doesn't physically divide. It doesn't ask you to like, how do you resolve that? And I think that for us is like the fundamental kind of fact of a book. So it's the spread is the basis for everything that makes a book rhetorical. It's not everything. The other thing is the cover, which is really important because it says this stuff belongs together. And that's also a super strong statement that has, in a book is absolutely clear, whereas like it's very fungible in a website because that could be different from one day to another day to another day, for better or for worse. So the kind of the resistances that are in a book are really like are the things that make it special for us now. So like its slowness, in a way, its slowness is the thing that's going to like make it possible to kind of slow down and kind of consider things and consider permanence in a way that's kind of really hard to do with like rolling over or scrolling or any of those kinds of phenomena of how we interact with information. So it's a good dinosaur. That was a movie title.
Kind of building on that, I just have a question.
Good dinosaur?
Yeah, good dinosaur. I have a question that sort of builds on that idea. And what's making me think of it is basically like the difference between this and this.
Okay.
And so I have
my glasses
a pencil for my iPad, and I have a pencil
yeah.
that has ink in it.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I know we've talked about a lot is we've sort of weathered about a decade and a half of our elders telling us that the hand is dead.
Mm-hmm.
Right? There's no more drawing. The hand's gone. End of the hand. Say goodbye. We're all typing and mousing, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that in one way, what's happened is the computer's caught up. It's now smart enough to keep up with the hand. So now the hand's reinserted into the system.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And one of the things I'm working on is the idea, and grappling with myself, is the idea that as I draw, there's a new kind of slowness in the device. Now that I'm actually generating the work with my hand, and there's a kind of recursive, very physical relationship with the medium again, and even a kind of tactility, although like pure haptics aren't there yet, but
yeah.
I could anticipate a time when actually the digital becomes haptic.
Yeah.
It's a hard question, but could you project a version of the book, not saying that the artifact and the fact that the idea of this thing as a resistor to that type of progress is important, but is there a kind of projected version of this where it could come back in a form and then actually leverage that type of fluidity in the medium without losing its object status or the idea that it can't be this juxtaposition between two things, or this is actually part of the digital world now?
Well, yeah, there still is we see some future fantasies where we have the digital newspaper where the ink refreshes as you kind of, so you're just doing this movement.
Harry Potter newspaper.
Yeah, that's right. Movies. Yeah, it's totally that, and I think one of the things that kind of might not work is actually the advantage of those types of systems is that the refreshability maybe plays against them, because the permanence of saying this matters enough to do this, like lay out a bunch of ink, kind of matters to our understanding of it as a cultural object.
Sure. But all of your input's digital.
A lot of it is.
Yeah.
Like we've tried putting resistance in that doesn't predicate that. It's a pain in the ass.
Sure.
And we don't have that much, our budgets aren't that big, so we can't do so much with that. Although that 256 book you can make on a Xerox machine, it's really fun. As far as like the object being, like the digital object becoming more and more special, I'm sure it will. And it should be, hopefully it won't be skeuomorphic. In other words, we can be done with that whole phase, please. So that it can be its own thing. There are some, as far as the communication of information, like the book as we make them, can't do audio very well, can't do video very well, and can do smell-o-vision, but not so well. So those kinds of ways of communicating information are beginning to be played out in some ebooks to some degrees of success. So like, if you want to see a good one, the beginning of that process, there's this series of publications that the CCA is doing that's associated with the Greg Lynn Show on the Archive of the Digital. Mm-hmm. And it basically has the content of the content, the text content and visual content of the book, plus it has interviews, and it also has actual interviews with the people that are being, talking about the things that are being discussed that are not just replications of the text, but actually extensions of the text, so you can have a kind of an updatability. And then the other thing is that because of that particular body of content, you have animation, either structural models or fly-throughs and that kind of stuff, which are really core content for those projects. And those are pretty good, and they're very they insist on being very digital. They never try to do simulation. So much so that you can actually, one of the toggles in it is you can choose between going through and spreads, that like weird zombie kind of book effect, or just scrolling through it. So you can choose your own kind of modality of reading, which is interesting. So there are people that are thinking about that. Problem is, in our little sector of publishing, there's not a lot of money. And so it's really only through institutions like CCA that we're able to start to see those things kind of overlap and come into the architecture book market.
Sure. it wasn't necessarily a call for it.
I think it's gonna, it'll continue. Hopefully, it'll be itself.
Thank you, Luke.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you very much.